Oh, it's so good to be in church today, huh? Man. You know, the testimony of saved lives never gets old. And I love the fact that we're celebrating that every week, that redemption story. And as I think about this series that we're in, it's called Satisfied, right? Christ for Empty Hearts. And Kendall today talked about the emptiness that she felt without Jesus. But then she gave her life to Jesus and she has a new identity, and that identity is in Christ. And so what a great series for us to take a look at in Colossians, Satisfied. Christ for Empty Hearts. We are moving from our identity in Christ to letting our identity be made known about Christ to people all around us. And last week, our application was a general application. Today, the application of our identity being lived out is very personable. It's close. It's right at home. And we're going to see in the text today that it's going to be talking about our marriages and parenting and the workplace. And have your toes been stepped on yet? Well, you're going to feel a little tension in the text, and that's okay. Everyone has a place in this text in Colossians 3. But the tension you might feel is you want to get around something, or you'd like to push through, or maybe that part isn't for me. It's kind of like this first sign that I saw a couple years ago. There's a bunch of us guys, we would go skiing, and my personality when I see a sign like this is like, well, that's really good for people who don't want some adventure in their life, but I would like to see what that's like to maybe, well, let's check out the boundaries a little bit, and well, sometimes it doesn't end up real well for me. Or maybe it's like this sign here, so conflicting. What is it? What is it saying? So I came in on 90 yesterday and today, and is it 90 miles an hour or is it 70? It's so, and you have to like, okay, I'll read each sign for what it says, and I gotta take it and obey it. I have to align myself with the roadmaps that are all around us. And today, as we take a look at this, we are going to be embracing God's roles. His plan for us is to align with His plan. His plan for us is to align with His plan. So I'd love to invite you to stand to your feet. I'd love to read this passage together, Colossians 3. I'm going to start in verse 18 and go through chapter 4, verse 1. Every time you see these two words put together, the Lord, I want you to say that out loud. Got it? Because that is who our identity is in, and that is where our identity and what we're trying to display to a lost and dying world, to those who are closest to us, we're in the Lord. Okay, let's read this together. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord, in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke our children, lest they become discouraged. Bondservants, obey in everything those who are in your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily, as for
the Lord
and not for men, knowing that from
you
will receive an inheritance as your reward. You are serving for the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your bondservants justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. Join me in prayer. Father, today we come before you and we see this passage and we can even feel a little bit of the tension. There's no doubt that this passage has some specific roles for us to live out. And today, I pray for our hearts that we will want to align with your plan. In this text, would you bring clarity? Would you bring conviction? Thank you for the challenge that's before us. And where appropriate, Father, help our hearts to make changes willfully and wantingly, that we might bring you more glory and that a lost and dying world might see what it's like to live in alignment with you. We love you and ask for you to do a good work today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can have a seat. Wives, submit to your husbands. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to the Lord. His plan for us is to align with his plan. There's human distinctions amongst men today, and we shouldn't be shy of that. There's men and women, but I want you to know that all are created equal. All have value. All have importance. All are in the image of God, and that's what we get to celebrate. Let's not forget that. But in these roles today, there are going to be some specific things that God is asking us to do. And the first one is, wives, submit to your husbands. And the tension, right? And how will we respond to that? Well, this is not the first time that Paul addresses this subject. He spoke to it at the church of Corinth, and he then spoke to it at the church of Ephesus. And now he speaks to it briefly to the church of Colossae. And he's just saying, here's a role that we need to embrace. And you ask the question, maybe in your head, why does he start out this passage with wives and not men? Because men, aren't we supposed to be the ones who have the ultimate responsibility to our family? And the answer is yes. But the reason why he starts out with wives submit first in these passages is he's dealing with the weaker first, then the stronger. The one who is subject to authority first, and then the ones who are in authority. And so the next question that you probably have in this text of what does it mean to submit, I think you should be asking that. And here's a definition. To submit means to voluntarily accept the authority of another person. To voluntarily accept the authority of another person. In this context, it's voluntarily accepting your husband's God-appointed headship and leadership. And so I think that's a place that when we are doing this well, we are submitting, we're falling into God's plan, and there's a blessing that comes along with that. And I think we've seen that throughout Scripture, through the Old Testament and the New Testament. But this is not the first and only area that God asks for submission to take place in. So I thought it might just be helpful for us to be reminded that all of us in this room have been told to submit in different areas in our life. In Hebrews chapter 12, it says that all of us must submit to God. In Romans 8, we must submit to his law. In Ephesians 5, we must submit to Christ. In Romans 13, we must submit to all governing authorities. So this is not an uncommon theme throughout the pages of the Bible, but it's a text today that has a specific application. Wives, submit to your husband. Well, let me ask you this question. How many of you believe that in marriage, husband and wife should be given 100%? Let me try that again. How many of you, let's hope that wasn't true. All right, survey says, how many of you believe that in marriage, both husband and wife should give 100%? Oh, much better, much better. That cup of coffee was really good right there. And because that is what we're asked to do. And when we're both giving 100% and we're leading well and we're watching God do a great work, those are really good days. But I can tell you that I've had many days where I have failed to give that 100%. But it doesn't give Sherry an opportunity to not live her 100%. And I can tell you in those days when I am not living 100%, that it's God's grace that is living in and through her to give her 100% and to embrace the role that is for her. And those make it a little challenging, right? Is that the little bit of the tension? There's ways that this tension can be felt all the way in this. And when you string several days together where one is not living 100%, we feel the tension even more. But it doesn't release us from the opportunity and responsibility that we have. Regardless of my lack, let me just tell you this, that I have been so blessed to be a part of a relationship with my wife for 28 years that even when, yes, you can clap for her for sure. She deserves all that and more, for sure. But when I am not living my 100% and she is living in a way that is gracious, what is happening in that moment is God is giving her everything that she needs, that she can understand that that commitment that she has, the Lord is going to honor that. The Lord is going to meet her in that. The Lord is going to give her strength. And I have never sensed once that she has wanted to escape out from under that. That's to her credit. And that's something I don't quite understand. And I don't know, I would say talk to her. How does she do that? I don't know, except that the Lord has given her what she needs to respond in a way that the Lord's word can be alive and active in her life. And so when a wife submits to loving leadership of her husband and follows that invitation for her, she is fulfilled by the Lord. And her husband is fulfilled in the Lord, even when it's not all in. But I can tell you this, wives, don't fight against this. Don't fight against this submission because it doesn't end well, because it's also saying that you're fighting against God's plan, God's alignment for your home. And those are tough things to hear. But I can tell you, I've watched it lived out, not just in my wife. I've watched it lived out into the home that I was brought up in. I was brought up in a very conflicted home, and maybe some of you can identify with this. Submission in a Christian home when people are trying to go the same path and trying to live for the Lord is one thing, but there's some of you who are here today, it's like, man, that's not the home I grew up in. Me too. My dad has nothing to do with the Lord, has never aligned with the Lord, and wants, doesn't want to have, and it affected our home inside and outside. It affected the people around him, and it affected my mom, and it affected me as her son and my sister as his daughter. It affected the home. And it was very negative. It was very hard to watch someone be lit up in the home. It was very hard to listen to language that was not affirming. It was hard to watch demeanor that was abusive in the way that it was carried out. And in our situations and circumstances, I watched a mom. I watched as her role of a wife to submit. And some of the fruit that she has is amazing because of it. But I want you to hear this. A loving husband will never ask his wife to submit to anything that's humiliating or degrading or violating her or going against God's principles and the word. A woman should never allow herself to be abused. It's not right. Abuse is not from God, and he will judge that. Ladies, if there's some of you that have a home situation that's even harder than what I've described, and abuse is there, I want you to know, as a church, we want to come alongside you. We want to care for you. We want to be of help to you. And if the authorities need to be involved, then that's another step that needs to take place. But I want you to hear that God's got a plan of submission, but it doesn't include for you being abused. Got it? Okay. It's really important for you to hear. Submission, another thing that it is not, it's not abuse. Taking abuse. Another thing that it does not mean, ladies, that you cannot share your opinion or that you cannot disagree. I love the fact that you have opinions. I think that's what's so healthy in marriage today, when we can share opinions and we can disagree and we can come to a decision that you're like, I don't know what the best thing is moving forward. That's okay. That's what we call out to the Lord, and we ask for wisdom, and he promises to give us without reproach, and it will be given to us. I want you to know, ladies, it's really important for you to be able to share something when you feel like there's a warning. Hey, I want to say this because this is a warning for us. I'm concerned for us in this way here. Those are right ways of seeing submission being lived out. But I will say, men, there's so many decisions that are being made in our home that with a wife who is understanding what submission is and trying to align and embrace this role, we have a chance to engage in a way that there's good communication In our home, we're talking about the finances. We're talking about what our day is like at work and the people that we're with and ministering to. We're talking through things. We're talking about aging parents and how are we going to care for them in a way that God would be most glorified. We're talking through these things so that it isn't like I catch her blindsided and say, we're going to do this. And then she's put in an awkward spot of, well, we haven't even really talked about that. So men, we have to do our job well, and we can be doing that better. Maybe you can understand this a little bit better with this graphic that shows up on the screen. This happened to me yesterday when I was on my motorcycle coming to Harvest, and all of a sudden 90 threw up this sign that like really disturbed me. Because it required me to do something that sometimes in this role, yielding can be really hard to embrace. And that's part of what this is. If one doesn't yield and you come to the part where it's running out of lanes, there's gonna be a problem. And there could be a really bad problem, or there could be a verbal exchange problem, or there could be someone who loses their cool problem. Good news was yesterday, in my spot, I yielded. I was on the motorcycle. I wanted to come out alive. But think about our situations and the chance that we have to live in a Christian home. There's going to be opportunities to yield. And submitting is yielding and embracing your role and living inside of it with everything that you have, that God would receive honor, that you would be protected, and that his name would be lifted up. Submitting is fitting in the Lord. Got it? Second one. Husbands, love your wife. Husbands, love your wife. There's some passages I was reminded of this week. In Proverbs 31, verses 11 and 12, an excellent wife, who can find? Men, God has provided us, wow, with a jewel, with a treasure, with something so precious. Let's not forget that. She is far more precious than jewels. Proverbs 18, 22, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. Men, we are so blessed. Amen. Men, we are so blessed. Wow, 9 o'clock, we got to wake up a little bit. I know the subject's heavy. I know the tension in the room. But men, we are so blessed. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. You know, love is used so many ways in our culture. I think about the other week we were out for breakfast with some friends. And I'm like, man, I love Swedish pancakes. And yesterday as I was on the bike, I'm like, man, I love riding this Harley. This is just great. I love the open air. But yesterday morning I woke up and I said, Sherry, I love you. Love. It's we say it in so many different contexts, in so many different ways. And this one here says, husbands, love your wife and do not be harsh with them. There's a couple passages I'd like to invite you to write down. Ephesians 5:22 says that we are to love our wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Men, 1 Peter chapter 3, husbands, live with your wife in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 4 through 8. I'd love for you to turn there. Let's read that one together. We have this one in our wedding. Maybe some of you did as well. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things. It hopes all things. It endures all things. Love never fails. Love never ends. What a great reminder. We get the chance to love our wives in this way. You know, recently I was on a phone call with the rest of the campus pastors, and one guy asked us, hey, if you would rate your marriage right now between a 1 and 10, what would you give your rating? And I'm like, well, you're assuming that it's not a 10 all the time. I'm kind of like bummed. But he's 100% right. I've just told you that I am not 100% all in, to my shame. but I want to be 100%, and I would love for our marriage to be a 10 out of 10 all the time. But there are some things that I am doing as a man that are not producing the righteousness of God in our home. There are some things that I can be doing better. And men, I would love for us to think about what are the things that we can do to improve in this area of loving our wives. It's an honor, it's a privilege, it's a responsibility, it's a command. Last time I looked, when he said that Christ loved the church and gave himself up for it, it meant that he was all in. He was willing to sacrifice to the point of what? Death, that we might have life. He gave everything for the bride of Christ. And that needs to be our perspective. That needs to be what we're all about. We need to be men who are all in our marriage. Love is more than feeling. It's an emotion. It's affectionate, it's tenderness, it's closeness. Love is devotion, it's determination, it's sacrifice, it's planning, it's prioritizing, it's dedicating. Love requires action. Men, how are things in your home spiritually? Husbands, love your wives. One of the things that we need to be as men is loving our wife and her development, in our development in the Lord. How much of our time in our home do we spend with our wife engaging in the scriptures? How much time do we spend praying or talking about the things that the Lord has placed on our heart? How much time do we spend, hey honey, let's memorize this passage together because this has meant a ton to me. It's been so helpful for me. Men, when's the last time you said, hey honey, we haven't been in a small group and we really need to get in community. We need to find a place to serve the Lord. We need to do some things together for the Lord. Because this passage in the Lord was mentioned how many times? 6 times in this passage. And as we love our wives, it needs to be about being in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives. And I think about it not just spiritually, but thinking about what are some of the things that we are doing emotionally and physically and for our future plans in the Lord. When's the last time we just spent some time together, not just in church, but going out for a date? Some of you consider this as a date, going to church. Because your kids are in Harvest Kids. So it's just the two of you. Check. But when's the last time you went out for a date? When's the last time you had a fun day together? When's the last time you thought about the hobby that you used to have 10 years ago, but you put it on the sidelines? What are you going to do to engage in something like that? When's the last time you went out for something simple like ice cream, even if it's McDonald's? Men, love your wife. Time with them is so important. I've told you, I grew up in a home that was conflicted. My dad was so verbally abusive, it was out of control. And so one of the values that I said in this passage here when it says, don't be harsh with her, was that I will never raise our voice in our home. And there can be some simple ways that men, we think about instilling values into our home, that our wife can see the plans that we have and that we're working on together and being developed, that show her that you love. But one of these commands is do not be harsh. And my dad, who was harsh, and I felt the effect of that, I'm like, Sherry, one of our values will be we will never raise our voice in our home. Because that broke the unity. That broke the peace that invaded into the joy of my heart. I felt that. And I don't know what you have as set up as a road path, as a road, as a map for you in your home, that you will not allow harshness to ever enter into it. But men, one of the things that we need to be reminded of is that we should not be harsh with her ever. Never threaten her. Never believe that she will ever experience being threatened. That would be harsh. Never rise up and be over her or be verbally domineering. That's abusive, men. Let's never do that in our homes. It tears apart the unity. It creates division. It brings hurt and harm. Emotionally, don't ever be harsh toward your wife. Don't ever put her down. Don't ever put her down in private or public. Don't be negative towards her. Look for ways to build her up. Look for ways that she knows that she is your bride. I know I'm speaking to some men here who aren't married yet, and these are some things that you can be looking forward to. How will the Lord bring someone into my life? And when he does, how will I cherish her and honor her and love her? How can I be all about this passage of loving your wife and looking for ways to do that well? Well, love her. Don't be harsh with her. I feel like we need to see what the Bible has to say again, because that harsh part is, it's like pollution. And when pollution comes into our house, it needs to go through a HEPA filter that we can see the purity of what the passage has to say, that we can represent him well. His plan for us is to align with his plan. Let me read it again. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy or boast. It's not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. Men, let's be about this with everything that we have. That's what this passage is calling us to. Well, his plan for us is to align with his plan. Children, obey your parents. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Now, we have Harvest Kids going on, but we might have some kids in here. We might have some junior hires and high schoolers in here. And it doesn't matter what kind of home you grew up in. This passage is for us. I've told you my home, maybe not the greatest home to grow up in, but it didn't mean that I was not responsible to obey my parents in everything. When you are young, it seems like the things that are asked of you are some tasks. Okay, it's time to get up, time to brush your teeth, time to take a shower, time to get ready for school. When you get home, put your play clothes on, get out with your friends, do these things, and we get to obey our parents. The hardest one I had was when the street light came on at the end of the day, I had to be at our home. And ideally, it would have been great if I would have been on the porch. But I loved hanging outside and playing sports. And so, hey, just a couple more tosses. Street lights on. Okay. Listen and obey right away. That might be a phrase for parents as you're thinking about raising your kids. But kids, if you would have a heart like that of listening and obeying right away, that's what this is about. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. As you move from kids to being teenagers, you think about the conversations that go on. The opportunities get bigger. The decisions get larger. Why do we need to obey? Because disobedience goes against God's plan. Why do we need to obey, students? Because disobedience goes against God's plan for you. And that doesn't end well. See, right now you have the blessing and the opportunity to live in a home where your parents are trying to instruct you and teach you in the ways that you should go. They're helping you understand who your identity can be in Christ and then how that can be lived out. And they're doing it in a way, in a loving home. Your parents love you, but there's going to be a time when authority comes into your life that they don't love you like your parents do. Like that first job that you get, you're going to have to submit to authority. That first coach that you have who talks a little different than your parents do. And they're instructing you in a way you're like, whoa, that's not. So learn this early in life so that we can embrace a heart value that God has for us. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Number four, fathers, encourage your children. Align with his plan. It says, fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Listen, dads, don't agitate, exasperate, irritate, Don't degrade your kids. These are not things that are helpful in the home. But looking for ways to pour into and care for and lead, this is what your kids are looking for. They love you. Think about it, dads. When's the special day? When's the last special day you had with your son or daughter? To Pastor Dave's credit, he took his couple daughters to the Cubs game. I don't know if they won or lost, and I don't think his kids cared either. But they got to spend some time with their dad. Hey, dads, encourage your children. When's the last time you went out for a bike ride? When's the last time you went out for a walk? When's the last time you went to a park? When's the last time you just told them you love them? Parents, fathers, encourage your children. Don't provoke them. Well, we had Pastor Ed Ollie here on Thursday night, and he spoke to our newly married ministry. And here's a couple more things that might be helpful for you as you think about fathers. Do not provoke your children. He gave us a little list, and one of them was parents who are making more withdrawals than deposits. That's not a good play. We need to be looking for ways that we can be pouring into our kids, because there is a day when we have to make some withdrawals. And if all we're doing is withdrawing and not pouring into, it's not received as well. We can encourage our kids. There's parents, fathers, correction versus instruction. If we're always correcting and not instructing, the tone of which we do things, they can become deaf to it. Verbally humiliating in public instead of affirming. Doesn't take very long for us to go through a store and watching a parent, watching a dad correct his son or daughter in a public setting and the humiliation that brings, instead of looking for ways to like take that to a different place. Looking for ways to publicly affirm your children in public, that they feel like my mom and dad, my dad loves me. Favoritism. That's not going to end well. Rules without relationship. Pour into your kids. Achievement-based approval is not a great thing for your kids, and overprotection. Don't be that parent. That's the helicopter parent. You're looking for ways to protect your kids, but don't hover over them. Give them some space and continue to grow. The Lord did not give children to Sherry and I. We wrestled through that disappointment, but it has been such a blessing to come alongside so many of you and watch you parent. We have been so blessed to watch what you are doing and pour into your kids. You have been so gracious to us by inviting us to come alongside of you as parents and to have some opportunity to pour into your kids. Fathers, don't miss this opportunity. Maybe you didn't grow up in a home where your father encouraged you. Be the first link in a new chain that passes this on to next generation, so that you can say, I lived out this passage. I aligned with his plan in his time right now. It's never too late. And maybe some dads need to go home and spend a little time with their kids today. Hey, son. Hey, daughter. I haven't been doing all of this well. Would you forgive me for that? I love you. It would apply into all of these passages that we've looked at so far. Number five, worker, serve God faithfully. 22 through 25, bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive an inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. Well, back in this day, in the Roman day, there were slaves. They had a lot of menial tasks. They were oftentimes dead-end jobs. They were assigned tasks at different times, at different places. Sometimes they'd be woken up early. Sometimes they'd be called in late. Sometimes they were dirty, sometimes they were dangerous, sometimes they were in somebody's home. And that's what was going on in this context here. In our context, in our country, slavery, It should have never existed. It's a sinful choice that man has made. As I mentioned before, all humans are equal, have dignity, value, honor, and worth. No one should be viewed as somebody else's property. That's our dark past. May it never be present again. But this passage also has for us some principles that we can take into our context today of employees, of workers for an employer. And how, even in the context of someone who is being lorded over, could respond in a way that their heart could be showing who their identity was with. And so in that day, in this day, there's some ways that we can show our identity in Christ to those who are our bosses, to those who are our employers, and it will even affect the employees that we work with. And I love that passage that says, whatever you do, work heartily as to the Lord. I remember 4 years ago when we left Rolling Meadows and we went to Phoenix to live for some time. I remember looking for a job, and I got my first job that wasn't in a church. And it was for this little company called Apple. And Apple took a risk and they hired me for 20 hours a week. But I got in the door and I was so excited that I had an opportunity to work for this company. And this verse came to my mind. Whatever you do as an employee, work heartily as for the Lord. Because who is my boss? The Lord. Remember? All of this is in the Lord. My boss is the Lord. And I was so thankful for the employer-employee relationship that I had. But I remember being told different things and working through different things and learning different things. And it became my desire. What else can I learn today? How else can I treat an employee that would show them that I care for them? How else can I treat a customer that they might see some value in some of the things that are going on? And I remember that I thought it was going to be my last day at Apple, because a customer walked into the store and she was in tears. And so I thought, that's my first indicator. I need to go spend some time with that lady. She was an older lady and she came in with tears and she sat down. I said, what is it that's going on? And she explained what had just happened, and it was a tragedy. And so we talked a little bit, and then I prayed for her in the store. And on that day, just by chance, one of the regional reps was in the store. So I finished my time with that customer and I walked over to my employer and I said, I totally understand if this is my last day here at Apple. I appreciate all the time that you've invested into me. I don't know if that fits into the value structure here, but I felt like that was best for her. And you know what they said? You were doing what was right for the customer. But I wasn't. That was part of it. I was doing it because the Lord had impressed that on my heart. Employees, work heartily as for the Lord. We should be the ones who are giving everything we have and are representing the best work ethic and attitude inside so that they can see, what does it mean to work heartily as for the Lord? It shows this way, so that your identity is seen as not someone who's just a good employee, but your identity is seen as you're a follower of Jesus, living out these truths right before them. That's what we're about. That's what this passage is trying to impress on our heart. Look at this phrase here. If a man is called to be a street sweeper, he should sweep streets even as Michelangelo painted, or Beethoven composed music, or Shakespeare wrote poetry. He should sweep streets so well that all the hosts of heaven and earth will pause and say, here lived a great street sweeper who did his job well. Martin Luther King. Let's be about that. Number 6. Leaders, treat others justly. Let's align with his plan. Masters, treat your bondservants justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. If you're an employer, if you're a boss, if you're someone who is given oversight, may they see where you are getting your strength from. May they see what your values are, and even greater than just the company that you are running, but the king that you serve, the master who you serve, it's the Lord. What an opportunity you have to let the light of Christ shine brightly in your workplace. May the values that they see in you as an employer represent the master. May the ways that you build into them and encourage them, may the ways that you correct them and train them, may they all be seen as people who are of and in the Lord. Your identity being lived out because you've been transformed. That's where hope is. Madeline, on that day when she was without hope seemingly, she got introduced to Jesus, and the table turned. And she testified to us that she gave her complete faith, put her faith and trust in Jesus to be her Savior. How awesome is that? And to think that we can live our identity out in our homes in personal ways, wives, husbands, fathers, submit, love, obey, encourage, work, lead in the name of Jesus. His plan for us is to align with his plan. Let me pray for us as the band comes and leads us in the closing song. Father in heaven, you are great. And I'm so thankful for passages like this that really, they cause us to really think about how we are living day to day, how our identity is being lived out in the places that are closest to us. Whether we are a husband or a wife or a child or a father, or an employee or employer. May it be said of us that our identity is in Jesus, that we're given everything we have to bring you glory and your good. We love you. Do a work in our hearts this week in Jesus' name, amen.